New tonight, 31 men arrested in Coeur d'Alene this afternoon associated with the known white supremacist group.
I've got one that can see.
Here we go. Another fake BS story. If you can't see CIA written all over this, then I don't know what to tell you. Check this out.
Happened this afternoon, just a few blocks from that Pride Parade, a parade that drew hundreds of people to downtown Coeur d'Alene.
The Pride Parade, of course.
Enforcement says they've been tracking this group and suspects that all the individuals detained showed ties to a white nationalist organization.
Coeur d'Alene police.
A white nationalist organization.
He's praising the actions of a quick-thinking 911 call.
I don't think this would have been as successful had we not had one extremely astute citizen who saw something that was very concerning to them and reported it to.
See something, say something. Heard that before?
Yes.
Saturday afternoon, that person reporting a, quote, little army loading into the back of a U-Haul. 10 minutes later, police make a traffic stop. This video shows the moment that truck's door slides open. 31 people arrested, all with suspected ties to the white nationalist group Patriot Front.
They had shields, shin guards, and other riot gear with them, including at least one smoke grenade.
A smoke grenade.
Arrests happening just blocks from North Idaho's Pride celebration, an event that organizers say drew hundreds of supporters.
We have been through so much, you know, so much harassment and attempts to intimidate, you know, on the psychological level. And the truth is that if you allow yourself to be intimidated, you let them win. And what we have shown today is that you will not win. Love will win.
Police now working alongside federal law enforcement to process all 31 arrests. The men representing at least 10 states, including Washington and Idaho, and as far away as Texas, South Dakota, and Virginia, all held on conspiracy to riot, a misdemeanor charge and a jail stay. Police are confident.
You can't tell me those guys right there with their face coverings aren't feds or CIA. Give me a break.
What do you think of what happened in Boston?
When we were looking for
bombing?
A pressure cooker and two teenagers, you know, and then they took over the whole city and shut it down. And to me, that looked a whole lot like martial law.
Yeah. Oh, God, I can't believe. See, this is why I didn't want to give this talk, because I knew that we'd have this conversation. And now it's on the record. All right. Let me take a step back. And we have to deal with it. Let me take a step back and a deep breath, because this is a very painful thing to talk about. So all over the world, we know, it's well established, the State Department and intelligence agencies engage in theater, and it's what they do, it's spycraft, to create spectacles and events that people may not realize are spectacles and events, but that, well, like the overthrow of Mossadegh in the 50s in Iran. It's well established. The State Department and intelligence agencies engage in theater, and it's what they do, it's spycraft, to create spectacles and events that people may not realize are spectacles and events, but that, well, like the overthrow of Mossadegh in the 50s in Iran. They'll funnel money to protesters, they'll, you know, fly people in to infiltrate protesters, they'll create fake newspapers, and so on. So we know that this happens in countries around the world. I believe that a law has been passed in the United States, I think it's part of the Defense Authorization Act, I need to confirm this, that, pardon me, now makes it legal to propagandize American citizens. Do we know about that? Yeah, it's true. And is it in the NDAA or is it in something else? Do we know?
It's a separate bill.
It's a separate bill. And it's been passed. It's now law? Do we know what the name? 2 years ago. Do we know what the name of it is?
I don't remember, but I reported on it.
Oh, thank you. Will you send me? the link?
Yeah.
Thank you. So what this means is, and I, you know, as a journalist to say these words, just I can't tell you with what a heavy heart I say them, but we've entered an era in which it is not crazy to assess news events to see if they're real or not real. And in the United States as well as overseas. And in fact, it's kind of crazy not to. In fact, it's kind of crazy not to. Now, you know, there's so much hype about what I just said, and so I want to be very clear about it so it can't be taken out of context. You know, there's, pardon me, this kind of reflexive vilification of anyone speculating about that because they become a conspiracy theorist, right? Well, just bear with me. You know, I've often thought about this because our intelligence agencies, and for, I respect spies. I mean, you know, who are doing, like, before it got out of control, I believe we need intelligence. I believe we need intelligence agencies. I don't think there's anything dishonorable about being in the intelligence services if you obey the Constitution and the law. But all over the world, our intelligence services are engaged in conspiring to create outcomes. That's their job. That's how they're successful. So now that it's illegal to propagandize in the United States, it doesn't surprise me that there's more and more products coming up in popular culture, more and more events in the news stream that seem to be, to my eye, to be subsidized. Let me give you some examples of that. I'm not talking about Boston right now. I'll get to that. We also talked earlier about infiltrators, right, and how they provoke violence. This is well established. So if we know that infiltrators by the police, NYPD, they've been documented, or other police forces, dress up like people they're not and provoke violence, why is it unthinkable that there might be spectacles that might drive an outcome in the news stream? Let me give you a couple of quick examples. And all I'm saying is we, unfortunately, and I have to say this to my fellow journalists as well, we've entered a time in which we need to be very skeptical about the news stream and look at it critically and ask for more verification and more inquiry. And that's just being good reporters. And it makes it, like this, there's spectacle fed into the news media in China. There's spectacle fed into, like Chile. How did Pinochet, you know, engage in his coup? He created photographs of a cache of weapons that the terrorists had, you know, hidden. Was it real? Was it not? Most historians think it wasn't. I mean, this is like not unusual, you know, in the process of creating a closed society. So if laws have made it legal to assassinate American citizens and legal to propagandize them, why should it be crazy or weird to think that that might be for a reason, right? All right. I saw the movie Zero Dark Thirty, thank you very much. And I have worked on two presidential campaigns, so I recognize political talking points. And I wrote a piece saying, this reads like the Pentagon signed off on the script. Because there were like chunks of political talking points identifiable to anyone who's worked in Washington. Right? And you don't come up with those if you're a writer writing a screenplay. And everyone was very upset. It was very controversial and scandalous. But in fact, belatedly, a news story came out saying that in fact the Pentagon had, I think, subsidized some of it, but had certainly consulted directly on the script. And I see more and more TV shows about the CIA and more TV shows about spies and gigantic blockbusters in which surveillance is normalized and gigantic blockbusters in which people are tortured to get them to talk in a way that might exonerate people who actually tortured people to get them to talk in Guantanamo. And there's all this money being pumped into these unaccountable, you know, terrorism fighting things. And now there's no law preventing that money from going through front organizations right into popular culture. So that's of interest to me. And so another thing I want to say, and there's so many people waiting to ask a question, but I just need to say this, is I'm skeptical of certain news events that seem more theatrical than the norm. Or I want to ask questions about them. Because nonsense can enter the media stream for purposes that have to do with advancing agendas, because no one's checking. That's all I want to say about that. Can I take more questions? So Boston, I guess my feeling about any of these things is, let's investigate. We need to investigate. We need to ask better questions. We need to interview the doctors at the hospital. We need to interview the victims. We need to, you know, get all the footage ourselves. We need to train citizens to be journalists and to have websites. I'm busy building one as a startup where citizen journalists can document events so that we're not leaving it to gatekeepers.
I thought that it was a matter of real concern that planted stories intended to serve a national purpose abroad came home and were circulated here and believed here, because this would mean that the CIA could manipulate the news in the United States by channeling it through some foreign country.
Do you have any people being paid by the CIA who are contributing to a major circulation American journal?
We do have people who submit pieces to other two American journals.
Do you have any people paid by the CIA who are working for television networks?
This, I think, gets into the kind of getting into the details, Mr. Chairman, that I'd like to get into in executive session.
Do you have any people being paid by the CIA who are contributing to the National News Services, AP and UPI?
Well, again, I think we're getting into the kind of detail, Mr. Chairman, that I'd prefer to handle in executive session.
At CBS, we had been contacted by the CIA. As a matter of fact, by the time I became the head of the whole news and public affairs operation in 1954, ships had been established, and I was told about them and asked if I'd carry on with them. I think it was entirely in order for our correspondents at that time to make use of the CIA agent chiefs of station and other members of the executive staff of CIA as sources of information which were useful in their assessments of world conditions.
Say that continues today?
Well, I would think probably for a reporter it would continue today, but because of all of the revelations of the period of the 1970s, it seems to me that a reporter's got to be much more circumspect in doing it now, or he runs the risk of at least being looked at with considerable disfavor by the public. I think you've got to be much more careful about it.
Where were you yesterday when the shooting started?
So yesterday I was in my AP environmental science class. We had just taken out all of our notes and we were about to pack up to leave school and we hear a pop. And it happened to be a gunshot that echoed through the hallway. And because of that, my teacher actually went and closed the door. But as soon as she closed the door, the fire alarm was pulled. So this sick man could come and get more soft targets. Still not thinking critically. We walked outside and that's when he started taking down even more people because of the fire alarm going off. And luckily, when we were actually going out to our fire evacuation zone, and as we were headed out there, a flood of people started running in the opposite direction, saying, go this way. So I followed the herd. And as we were running like in this one direction, we happened to be running towards the shooter. But thank God, there was a janitor there that told us not to go any further because there was because the gunman was right there. And he told us, he got us all into one classroom with the help of Chef Kurth. And as a result of that, I think they saved easily 40 lives that day.
On the day of the shooting, I got my camera and got on my bike and rode as fast as I could 3 miles from my house to the school to get as much video and get as many interviews as I could. Because I knew that this could not be another mass shooting.
What the hell did you just say?
On the day of the shooting, I got my camera and got on my bike and rode as fast as I could 3 miles from my house to the school to get as much video and get as many interviews as I could. Because I knew that this could not be another mass shooting.
So yesterday I was in my AP environmental science class. We had just taken out all of our notes and we were about to pack up to leave school and we hear a pop.